بسم الله الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه. طيب أسمع إن شاء الله جزاكم الله خير. We continue with the كتاب الأضحية جزاكم الله خير. And today بإذن الله تعالى we're going to be talking about the timing for the أضحية. The timing for the أضحية. One should slot or sacrifice his udhiyah, his qurbani, as some brothers call it. First of all, there's no doubt that sacrificing before Fajr, it is not allowed. And there is an ijma', as Ibn al-Mandhar brought it, and Ibn Abd al-Barr likewise, and you will find it in Shurh Sahih Muslim. He says, أَجْمَعَ أَهْلُ الْعِلْمِ عَلَّا أَنَّ الْأُضْحِيَا لَا يَجُوزُ ذَبْحُهَا قَبْلَ طُلُوعِ الْفَجْرِ مِنْ يَوْمِ النَّحْرِ وَاخْتَلَفُوا فِيمَا بَعْدَ ذَلِكَ. So the ijma', the consensus, it is not allowed to slaughter before Fajr. That's not debatable, that's ijma'. And then the disagreement came after Subh. We will see inshaAllah ta'ala. So before Subh, before Fajr, you will not be accepted. And then after Fajr, there is different opinions among the ulama. We'll see which one is the strongest, bi'idhnillah ta'ala. وهم يا أخوان إمام الشافعي رحمة الله عليه likewise ابن المنذر and others they said the Fajr the sunrise after the sunrise enough time for us to pray Eid and do the khutbah. So you calculate after the sunrise when is allowed for you, which is Qadr Rimh, to do Salat and khutbah, to give enough time for the Salat and khutbah. They said if you slot after this time, yeah, let's say you say the time for, let's say for argument's sake, the time when is allowed for you to do Salat al-Eid, we will see when we talk about Salat al-Eid inshallah, is let's say 6 o'clock. Class? So what you do, you calculate more or less how much time you need for the Salat and the Khutbah. Let's say half an hour. So Imam Shafi'i and Dawood and Ibn al-Mundhir and others, they said, if you slow at this time, I give enough time when it's permissible for you to do khutbah and pray, and you give enough time, which is about half an hour, which is known, yeah, the customs of the country, then any time after that, your slotting will be accepted. Is that clear, Ikhwan? Mafhoom? And they said, regardless if the imam prayed or not praying, or the imam has slotted or he hasn't slotted, and if he lives in a sort of in a country or in a countryside or in a city, doesn't really matter. Is that clear? So this is the first opinion. First opinion is based on the time, is when the time for Salat al-Eid come, you give enough time after that time to pray and khutbah, and after that, regardless what the imam did. Mafhoom? Even if the imam has not finished the khutbah, or the imam slotted yet, you will not matter. This is the first opinion. Abu Hanifa, the Imam Atta, he says, the Fajr al-Thani, it's a Fajr. When the Fajr come, this is when you can slot. And for the people Jazaakumullahu Khayr. Who lives in a city, he's talking about the people who lives in remote places and all that, that's Fajr. But the people who live within the city, Barakallahu Fikum, he says, till the Imam prays, and he gives a khutbah, then you can slot. You have to wait for the Imam. Khalas? The first opinion said you don't have to wait for the Imam. The second opinion said you have to wait for the Imam. قال حتى يصلي الإمام ويخطب. If Imam decide to do khutbah after an hour instead of shiktway after subh, which is qadr al-ramh, which is about half an hour or something, he said, no, I will stay, like we do here, for instance, we pray Eid 10 o'clock. 10 o'clock is late. We only do it to help people to come. So if the Imam decided to do 10 o'clock, this opinion says you're not allowed to slot unless the Imam have already prayed and did khutbah. The third opinion, Jazakallah Khair, they said, and this is held by Imam Malik, he said you're not allowed to slot till the Imam has prayed, done the khutbah, and slotted himself. The second opinion, only pray and did the khutbah. This one, no. Pray, did the khutbah, and slotted. Before? And slotted. That's Imam Malik. Only then, you're allowed, or your sacrifice would be accepted. So this is not too much confusing, inshallah. Ikhwan. Is that clear, Yahi? It's not too much confusing. Before? So, the first one, they said any time, Jazakumullah Khair. When the time for the Salat will come, for Eid, and you give enough time, regardless the Imam has done khutbah or no, you give enough time for the Imam to give the khutbah and the Salat, you calculate half an hour, for instance, and then you slot regardless what happened to the Imam. The second opinion, Jazakumullah Khair, Abi Hanifa and others, they said, for the people, they said, for the people who lives in villages is after Fajr, second Fajr, and for the people who live in the city, till the Imam prays and does the khutbah. The third opinion held by Imam Malik, he said till the Imam prayed, did the khutbah and slotted. Can you see the difference, Ikhwan? And slotted. The last opinion, Barakallahu Fikum, is opinion held by Imam Ahmed, Rahmatullahi Alayhi, Rahmatul Wasi'ah. He says, لا يجوز قبل الصلاة ويجوز بعدها قبل ذبح الإمام. He said, it is not allowed before the Salat, but it's allowed after the Salat, only the Salat. Even if the Imam has not slotted yet. Even the Imam has not slotted yet. Those are the opinions. Now, if you go back to a hadith, to the hadith of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we have many. Some of them we will bring, inshallah, narrated by Imam, mainly by Imam Bukhari and Muslim, the like of the one narrated by Anas ibn Malik, when Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, من ذبح قبل الصلاة فإنما ذبح لنفسه. ومن ذبح بعد الصلاة فقد تم نسكه وأصاب سنة المسلمين. The hadith is clear. The hadith is not talking about the timing to be considered. No talking about the Imam he has slotted or not. He only talking about the Salat or the Khutbah. So the main thing, this is as you can see, the main opinions of Imam Ahmed. It's all about the Salat. Once the Salat is finished, that's what Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says. Again, Al-Bara ibn Azib, radiallahu anhu, he says, سمعت النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم يخطب. He's narrated what the Prophet was saying in his sermon. And he said, إِنَّ أَوَّلَ مَا نَبْدَأُ بِهِ مِنْ يَوْمِنَا هَذَا أَنْ نُصَلِّي. Either the first thing we do, or which we usually do in our day, in this day, the day of Eid, is to pray. And then, ثُمَّ نَرْجَعْ فَنَنْحَرْ ثُمَّ أي to feed التَّرْتِيب. The order, it means after with orders. I pray and then we slot. فَمَنْ فَعَلَ هَذَا فَقَدْ أَصَابَ سُنَّتَنَا. Whoever did that, then he has act upon the sunnah. وَمَنْ نَحَرَ فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ عَفْوًا فَقَدْ أَصَابَ سُنَّةَ. وَمَنْ نَحَرَ فَإِنَّمَا هُوَ لَحْمٌ يُقَدِّمُهُ لِأَهْلِهِ لَيْسَ مِنَ النُّسُكِ شَيْءٍ. يعني whoever did other than that, مفهوم يا أخوان, فمن فعل هذا فقد أصاب السنة. أو other than that, then he hasn't. And then the hadith came that we which we use is, oh messenger of Allah, and this by Abu Burayda, he says, I slaughtered a sacrifice before Salat. And then the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, replace it by another one. You replace it by another one. So those two ahadiths, Jazaakumullahu Khayr, clear-cut ahadiths, are a proof that the timing, the timing for slaughtering is after the Salat. And no need for you to wait for the Imam, nor for his khutbah or for his slaughtering. Imagine if the Imam couldn't afford to slaughter. Aren't we going to slaughter, Ikhwan? As we said in the Fath by Ibn Hajar and others. Because if we said the Imam has to slaughter, then we are attaching all this ruling hukum on the Imam. If the Imam cannot afford to slaughter, then no one will slaughter. And even if the Imam has slaughtered before Salat al-Subh, he was an ignorant Imam, he didn't know. Are we going to slaughter after the Imam before Subh? We said no. So as you can see, the strongest opinion here, based on the Hadith of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, which are clear, that the slaughtering should be done after the Salat. Once the Salat is done, whatever place you are, you pray. Once you pray, you slaughter. Regardless if Imam slaughtered, not slaughtered, regardless where you are, regardless the timing, the timing, as long as it's after Subh. Is that clear, Ikhwan? And this is the timing for the slaughtering. Jazakumullahu Khayra. Before? Now, when is the last time? How much time do we have? Is it one day, half a day, 3 days? What is آخر وقت? What is the last time for slaughtering? قال اختلف العلماء في آخر وقت للأضحية على نحو الاختلاف الذي تقدم في كتاب الحج that we will see before. بارك الله فيكم في أيام النحر. The ulama has different opinions based on the masail or the matters of Hajj وأيام التشريق and so on and so forth. But it is obvious, بإذن الله تعالى, that it can be extended till the 13th of the Hijjah. The 13th of the Hijjah. But no doubt, the best is to do it in the same day. But for argument's sake, because it happened, people cannot afford money or things happen, they still have those 3 days, the 13th. I the 10th, and then you have 11, and you have 12, and you have the 13. The last time for your slaughtering is the 13. Mafhoum, Ikhwan? So you're allowed, Jazakumullah Khair. We will see, inshallah, when we talk about Eid, how long is the Eid? Inshallah, we will do this, inshallah, bi-idhnillahi ta'ala, maybe tomorrow, after tomorrow. And we'll talk about the how long is the Eid. But Jazakumullah Khair, what the statement of the ulama, is it 1 day, is it 2 days, is it 3 days, is it the 3 days of ayam Jazakumullah Khair al-tashriq and so on and so forth. Ala kulli hal, so the time can be extended, which is apparent and obvious to the dalils, up to the 13 days of Dhul Hijjah. مفهوم؟ هاي ذا 3 دايز ايام بيكون ايام التشريق مفهوم؟ كيز ستيل عيد بيكوز وي نوت الاود تو فاست وي ويل توك اباوت ذس ان شاء الله مفهوم يا اخوان؟ مفهوم؟ سو ذا بيست تايم از ذا داي اوف عيد but can be extended in some Muslim countries all over the world. Sometimes the cost of the sheep go a bit at the time, and this is sad. They meant to help, but people take this. You can see it both sides because you know the shepherds and so on and so forth. They will do this for living. That's the only one time when they can sell, Eid mainly. So this is the only one time they can send and can make money for the rest of the year. We don't understand that, but at the same time, they need to look into the people, the laymen, the poor, those who father that work hard and it has not, it doesn't have enough. Suddenly, at the time of Eid, it goes higher. Well, people wait after the Eid within a day. The ship, subhanAllah, is I nearly said half a price, but at least 30-40% off. So a father that cannot afford it, we say you can wait and buy it the second or the third day. If you can afford it and it'll be cheaper, then why not? At least you give him this option. Jazaakumullahu Khayr. Mafhum? Give him this option. It's not يعني أحجروا وضيقوا ما وسعه الشرع. We should not tie and make narrow what the Sharia has made. MashaAllah Tabarak Allah has given us easiness and give us more options. Is that clear, Ikhwan? طيب. What is مكان الذبح? Where should we slaughter the sheep? It is allowed to slaughter any place he wishes. Likewise, he is allowed to slaughter at the musalla, the place where they pray, but not in the masjid, outside. As he was narrated in Hadith Jundub ibn Sufyan, he says, and this hadith is narrated by Imam Muslim and others, he said, شهدت الأضحى مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. He witnesses the الأضحى, the Eid of Adha with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then he was describing what happened in that day. He said, once the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم prayed, مفهوم؟ قال, فلم يعد أن صلى وفرغ من صلاته سلم. He did the salam. فإذا هو يرى لحم أضاحي قد ذبحت. And he saw some of the people had already slaughtered before he even finished his salat. Then he said, صلى الله عليه وسلم, his famous statement, whoever has slaughtered before the end, the salat, before we pray, then he should slaughter another one instead. And whoever is about to slaughter, he will slaughter with the name of Allah. What can we benefit from this, as Ahl al-Ilm said? Ibn Umar says, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يذبح وينحر من مصلى. Hadith narrated by Bukhari, by the way. Sahih. And he used to slaughter at the musalla, the place where he prays after the salat. So if we combine the two stories, Jazakumullah Khair, as you can see, even the Sahaba themselves made mistakes and they slaughtered and sacrificed before the timing. So therefore, it is better for the Imam to slaughter at the musalla if it's possible. We're not to show the people when they should slaughter, how they should slaughter. Is that clear, Ikhwan? And that is the aim of it, that is the benefit of slaughtering in the musalla. So teaching the people how to slaughter and teaching the people the timing of slaughtering. So that would be the best for the Imam. And then they can do on the front and you can be corrected. It's like learning. Otherwise, you slaughter anywhere you like. As long as it's a place that is not, Jazakumullah Khair, like a masjid inside the masjid or a place where there's adriha, afanallahu iyyakum, where people worship graves and so on and so on. People don't like the word worshipping graves, yeah? It is worshipping graves. There's no trying to find excuses. If you call upon those who are in the grave, you're worshipping them. Because the dua huwa al-ibadah. Dua huwa al-ibadah. Based on the Quran and the Sunnah. So let's because people we have the kind of irja and people become even jahmi because of those things, and whoever says that those who call other than Allah mushrikun, oh, those are khawarij, or those are takfiriyun. Subhanallah. What would you call them? What would you call somebody who joined partners with Allah in his dua, in his ibadah? What would you call somebody who thought for others than Allah, like they do in the graves? What would you call somebody, Ya Ali Madad, Ya Hussein, Ya Abdul Qadir, what would you call him? What would you call him? And Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when the Sahaba and Hadith Anwat, when they said, Ij'annana, يعني ذات أنواط كما لهم ذات أنواط يعني the tree where they used to hang the weapons for التبرك and the تبرك itself it can only be shirk أكبر if you believe that the tree itself or the stone itself or that place itself is that thing that can bring you benefit or remove harm from you, then it becomes major shirk. But if you don't believe that and you believe this is just the way, but only Allah, we say this is minor shirk. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he made takbir 3 times. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. When Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam do takbir 3 times for something important, how did he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith of that Anwat, resemble the action of the Sahaba, even though the newly and the deen and so on and so on, we'll talk about this, we did that in the Kitab al-Tawheed, but leave that. To what? To the people of Musa. What did the people of Musa ask them? Ij'alana aliha kama lahum aliha. Make us a deity, a god, like they have a god. Like they have a god, afala Allahu. وإياكم. That's off topic, but it's very important. الجهل عم. عم الجهل. الجهل has been spread on the internet. سبحان. And that for the sake of whatever reason. Even though they know the حق. They know the حق. They know the حق. And because of agendas, hidden agendas, they will close their eyes in that. The same people who would talk badly about those ulama who do tawassul by other than Allah, and then suddenly if somebody criticized those which is an alim himself and said this is kufr, oh, kafir, or takfiri, or have shia takfiri tendency, that's al jahl, hamqa, deluded people, they have ilm and damage too. Afan Allah wa ayyakum. Tayyib, mafhum ya ikhwan? This is the, you know, it is Jazaakumullahu Khayr, as Ibn Umar says, yustahabbu, as the ulama says, lil-imam wa yanzbah bil-musalla, l-imam, it is recommended for him to slaughter in the place where he prays after, if there is facilities, for those reasons, to show the people, to teach the people, let the people know, even if people have different opinion, some of them say, oh, I'll wait for the imam, at least this is the opinion, he's the imam, just slaughtered. Is that clear, ikhwan? Tayyib. Now, what can we benefit from that meat? To eat from it, number one. To give sadaqah to the fuqara. And to put some aside. Is that clear? So those are 3 things we can do with the sacrifice. To eat from it. To give some as a sadaqah. And to keep some. Barakallahu fikum. For the future, for the days ahead. Nowadays you can put it in a freezer. In the time of the Sahaba, in the time where they didn't have fridges, because you can say how they're going to keep some away, they used to put what you call al-khala', not al-khala' as a divorcer, takhli'. It's like what you do with vinegar for gherkins. They do exactly the same thing, or for onions or things like that. They do the same thing but with salt. They put a lot of salt in the meat, and then they keep it for days and months, and then they can eat it later on. Allah Azza wa Jal, he said, ليش, the verse, Ya Rabbi, قال ليشهدوا منافع لهم ويذكروا اسم الله في أيام المعلومات على ما رزقهم من بهيمة الأنعام ثم قال فكلوا منها وأطعموا البائس الفقير. Allah is talking about the one which we do with the animals, the sacrifice and sacrifice. It's like eat from it and feed the poor one. Likewise, النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال من ضحى منكم فلا يصبحن بعد الثلاثة وبقى في بيته منه شيء. This is very important. We're going to bring this hadith because it's very important. This hadith is very important. Barakallahu fikum. Whoever slaughtered or sacrificed, then by the third day you should have no meat left. And I just said we can put some away aside. So this is the first. You see, half of the hadith. If you finish the hadith, with the hadith is sahih, is in Bukhari Muslim. Some people will use this hadith, but they never finish it. Lid, قال فلما كان العام المقبل, and when it was the next year, look what he said. قالوا يا رسول الله, the Sahaba said, oh Messenger of Allah, do we do like what we did last year? I eat by the third day, the meat should be finished. If not finished, give it away. Then the Prophet replied, say, قلوا وأطعموا وادخروا فإن ذلك العام كان بالناس جهدا فأردت أن تعينوا فيها. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم given the حكمة. He said this year eat, feed, I others, and keep some. الادخار is to keep some away. He said last year I told you, Barakallahu fikum, not to keep anything, so you can give others who are struggling, so you can help your brothers. Is that clear, Ikhwan? So you give the hikmah, the reason why. So the same way is applicable here. If there's a lot of people around you and they have not slaughtered, then use the part of the hadith which you eat within the third day, whatever is left, give it to the sake of Allah. If the people have been slaughtered, wallahi alhamd, and there's enough meat to go around, then keep some for you, inshallah. Mafhoom? Now, another mas'ala, very important. When Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam qala, kulu, eat. Hada amr. Amr is a command. Mafhum? Well, amr is wujub. It means compulsory. Is it compulsory? Do I have to eat from the meat? Is it compulsory? Do I have to eat from the meat? Or do I have as well, وَدَّخِرُوا, do I have to keep some? Is it compulsory? Ahl al-Ilm says, جمهور العلماء, he said, it's not compulsory. It's rather recommended. It's not wajib. You don't have to eat from it. It'd be better, recommended, but it's not a must. Before, it's not a must. Likewise, it's not a must for you to keep some. You can give it all away. And the majority of the ulama, they said that. And the majority of the ulama, they said, it is recommended to give a third. And eat a third. And some of them said, يعني يتصدق بالثلث ويطعم الثلث ويأكل الثلث هو وأهله. يعني to feed the third, to give sadaqah as a third, and you and a family can have a third. But regarding this third, a hadith which are da'ifa. But you hear it in the Muslim land, but those are hadith are da'ifa. But rather, he can split the sheep as he wishes. And even if he give it all away, and that's Bayt al-Qasid, that's the proof we're going to use. He can give it all away without eating anything. Without eating anything. What is the proof? Hadith Ali رضي الله عنه that النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أمره أن يقوم على بدنه. النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم commanded and ordered Ali to take care of his slaughtering, which is the camel. وأن يقسم, that he should split all the camel, كلها لحومها وجلودها, everything. And he commanded him and ordered him to give everything away. And he should not give to the jazzar, to the butcher, the one who slaughtered. The one who cut, you should not give him from the meat. You want to pay him from your own pocket, that's another story. We'll talk about this later. But you should not give him anything from that meat. So as you can see, this clear-cut hadith. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he commanded him, he ordered him to slaughter for him, and then to give all the meat away, everything away. He didn't eat nothing from it. This is the dalil, that you don't have to eat from it. The dalil is not wajib upon you. It is better, it is mustahab, it is recommended, it is mandub, it is from the sunnah. No doubt. Is it wajib? It's not wajib. Likewise, it is haram to sell. You can eat, you can give sadaqah, you can give as a gift, you can keep some inside, do whatever you want. But it's not allowed to sell any of you meat. You can say, oh, I'm going to slaughter the sheep, I'm going to sell the skin. Or I'm going to sell some of the meat that I don't eat. No. Or I'm going to pay the butcher, whoever slaughtered the meat. No, you don't do this. But for me, Ikhwan, you don't do this. Barakallahu fikum. It is not allowed. Even though there's a hadith which are da'ifa, when Nabi Sallam said, وَلَا تَبِيعُوا لُحُومَ الْهَدِي وَالْأَضَاحِي فَقُولُوا وَتَصَدَّقُوا وَاسْتَمْتِعُوا بِجُلُودِهَا وَلَا تَبِيعُوهَا. Even though it is a hadith, mafhum, by Imam Ahmad in Musnadih, but the hadith, it is da'if. Mafhum? It is da'if. And the sacrifice is like a zakawat, like a zakat. Or kafarat. It's all similar. Mafhum? They are only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're not allowed to do business with it. To sell or to do anything. Just give it. Now, is it ijma'? This is not ijma'. By Imam Shafi'i. Madhab Imam Shafi'i. Wa Ahmed. Barakallahu fikum. That says no. Abu Hanifa, he says, bay'u ma sha'a minha wa yatasaddaq, aw yabi'u ma sha'a minha wa yatasaddaq bi thamanihi wal adhhar 'adamuhu. Wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. Yani he said he can sell some and he can give what he says as a sadaqah. I said no. What is apparent, what is obvious, Jazaakumullahu Khayr, is this is sacrifice. When you thought وَنُسُكِي وَمَحْيَايَ لِلَّهِ, that's for Allah. خلاص, it's a sadaqah. Don't sell it. You did it for the sake of Allah. خلاص, give it away. Eat, give away, give as a gift, give whatever you want to do, but don't do business with it. But from حتى الجزار, حتى even the butcher, لا يعطى الجزار أجرته من الأضحية. الجزار, the butcher, whoever slaughtered you meat, you want to pay him, you can pay him for his job. But don't give him, don't say, oh, you do my sheep and I give you a leg. Even if he's a poor person. No, you don't pay him. You want to give him, give him. You can pay him and then still give him because he's a poor person. That's another thing. But don't give him as a reward for what he did. As a reward for what he did. Is that clear? Remember the hadith when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said to Ali, قَالَ وَلَا يَعْطِي أو ولا يعطي في جزارتها شيئا. He said to Ali, don't give from it anything to those who were slaughtered and cut the meat. So clear cut dalil that is not, it is forbidden to pay the butcher or the person that slaughtered meat out of the meat or out of the animal or out of the qurbani or the sacrifice. Barakallahu fikum. Is that clear, ikhwan? Now, what is the best thing to do, Ikhwani Jazakumullahu Khayra? What is the best thing to do? To give money or to give the animal itself? Jamahir Ahl al-Ilm qalu al-udhiya afdal min at-tasadduq bi thamaniha. Al-udhiya, the sacrifice, is better than to give it cost money. Don't give whatever the money, let's say the sheep cost £200. What is the best? To buy the sheep and give it as a slaughtering or to give it £200? Jamahir ulama, majority of the ulama, they said to give the sheep is better. Why? Because giving the slaughtering is sunnah, it is highly recommended. And it's debatable to the ulama if it's wajib or not wajib. Sadaqatu at-tatawwu', to give them money, Jazaakumullahu Khayr, yani it is recommended, but it's not wajib. Not even highly recommended. Not only that, the sacrifice, ayahuan, is what? Is the symbols of the Muslims, the virtues of the Muslims, the symbols of the Muslims. And this is where Imam Sheikh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah and others have said. So don't, people might have that. Layman may say, look, I can't deal with it. I'll give money and Eid and better than, well, I buy some meat and I give sadaqah. No. I know people who refuse to do Hajj, by the way. I know them. I know people out of ignorance when they had money. The attention was there. That's why I said this. The attention was there. When they were given money, and that is, we're talking like in the 70s and 70s and 80s, yeah? Early 80s, late 70s. Back home, it was an old lady that I know her personally. She'll be given money to do Hajj. Maskina. She's a good woman. Nahsibuha, Allah hasibuha. She passed away. Allah have mercy on her. She'll be given money from her kids, her sons. And she was in her 80s at that time to do Hajj. So she took the money and she gave them away. I believe some of them, Palestine, some of them, fi sabilillah. And she didn't do Hajj. SubhanAllah, miskina. She thought she was doing the right thing. She thought people, because the Hajj at that time was very expensive. She said, oh, the people would benefit from it more than me. You understand me? That was wrong. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward her for her attention, but he was wrong. Ilm is very important, ikhwan. Don't go with your heart, yeah? Go with the text, with the dalil. Barakallahu fikum. Allah said, fi dhalika falyatanafasul mutanafisun. In that we should compete. With that, we should compete. Food, yes, you can give the food and the money, that's no problem. But if the money, it means you're going to miss Hajj, which is a pillar, no, you shouldn't miss the Hajj for something, give this sadaqah. But for me, ikhwan, now, if somebody bought a sheep and then it was stolen from him, and that is very sad. It happened in some Muslim lands. Subhanallah, he was watching someone in a Muslim land. Maskini was tied up, and every single animal cutters he had were taken away from him, and that's the only one time that he works. And he was tied up with knives and things. Alhamdulillah, they haven't killed him. And they took everything, about 80 sheep or something like that. Poor man. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa khair. So people do this. I've seen videos that have been sent to me, some Muslim country where people stealing, subhanAllah, they steal to slot. Some people are desperate for the kids, to feel pressure. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide them. But if someone, for instance, he bought a sheep, and then he lost it, got stolen, or died. Mufhum? What do we do? Do we have to buy another one? Ahl al-ilm, Jazakumullah Khayr, said you don't have to. Based on a story that happened, narrated by al-Bayhaqi and others, he said that Tamim ibn Huwais, He said that he bought a goat in Mina to do udhiyah with it. فضلت. The goat was lost. He lost his goat. قال فسألت ابن عباس. I've asked ابن عباس regarding this matter. فقال ابن عباس لا يضرك. Said no harm. That means you don't have to replace it. You don't have to do anything. مفهوم؟ Ibn Umar, in one narration, again, this narration was by Imam Malik, rahmatullahi alayhi, and Imam Bayhaqi again, he says, whoever got an animal to sacrifice, and then the animal was lost or died, he said, if كَانَثْ نُذْرًا, abdalaha. If it's another vow that he took, then he should exchange it, do another one. وَإِنْ كَانَ تَطَوْعًا, if he was not another, a sunnah or tatawwu extra, it's up to him. If he want to change it, he change it. فَإِنْ شَاءَ تَرَكَ, if he wishes, then he doesn't have to change the slotting for another one. And this is the same if he get ill or he falls. Those things happen. People will bring their animals into the balconies, and the animal will fall down, and that's the father has to buy another one, and so on. This is not, you don't have to. Barakallahu fikum. Is that clear? Now, this fatwa here, we might talk about it another time more. Can we send the sacrifice to another country? Can we do that? Are we allowed to do so? No doubt the asr, the basis, is to slaughter what you are, where you are. The basis is to slaughter in the country you are in. That's the asr. But is it wajib to do it in your country? It's not a wajib. There's no manner to transport the meat or to transport the udhiyah itself to another country. If there is a maslaha. If there is a maslaha. If there is a country who are so poor or they only eat meat at that time. If it's possible, you can do two. One in your country, another one there, even better. But if somebody, he can't, but he feels guilty, and this is the only one time he can put joys and happiness into those people's heart, then why not? He's allowed. And we said to eat from it is not a wajib. And we said the hadith of Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, what he did, what he asked Ali to do before. Is that clear? Mufhum, ikhwan? So this is, you might hear another brother might say differently. Mufhum, I might use this, but we have a dalil that it's not a wajib. So we're not going to make it, ikhwan, Jazaakumullahu Khayr, because of an alim might bring a fatwa and so on and so on. Plus, remember, we're not talking, we are not in a Muslim land. We are in a country where you don't even see your sheep. You go and order your sheep from the butcher. It's rare, only few of us that go, and if you plan to go to slot, it means you're going to leave your family behind for a whole day. And the usr, the hardship comes with it, is next to impossible, because some brothers have put themselves into dangers many years ago. Some of them bought a live sheep. It's true, ikhwan, wallahi akhi. And he took his sheep, who he lived in a building. As like he kidnapped him. He put him under the towel. And he left him the night before in the bathroom. And he slaughtered the sheep in the bathroom. He told me. It's not like, how do I know? He told me, the brother. And I told him Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide him. He slaughtered his sheep in a bath. It's impossible, ikhwan. It's not like in a Muslim man you can do this. So most of us won't even see. And you know what's sad? What said, ikhwan? Hey, na'am. What said, akhi Hussam? This is true. And this is not from hearsay, yeah? From people who works into this within a domain. This is the domain, butchers and meat delivery. And this is very sad. Very, very sad. And I'm not saying everyone is like that. But people, for instance, when you slaughter aqiqah, you need to give them names. Yeah? That's Hussam, have a newborn baby. Abdullah, he said, here you go, this is my son's name. And he meant to slaughter and name the Aqiqah Bismillah Allah Akbar for this newborn baby. And this brother that I know him, watch, it's not a second hand news. I know the brother personally for nearly 30 years. And he used to do delivery. And his boss meant to be practicing brother, meant to be a practicing brother. Well, I need to say this not to put fear for people, but for you to understand, because people making it sound as if when you slot here, you're 100% sure, if because you know you're trusting people with your meat and so on and so forth. I'm not saying therefore you have to doubt them, but I just want to give you an example. And then brother forgot to do aqiqah, and the butcher said, "Where's my aqiqah?" And the brother on the phone, he told him to write aqiqah and put into the normal meat and give him two. It means he lied to him. Sallallahu alayhi. Some people who slaughter in this country don't even pray. Some people are upon shirk and so on and so forth. Now let's not go into that. For those who say, "Oh, we have to slaughter," the ulama, the like of Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen and others, we talked about slaughter in the country. Mainly, if you see a sheep, if this virtues and this rituals of slaughtering can be shown to the kids, and you know, you, as we do back home, you bring sheep 2-3 days before, the kids will leave that, look after the sheep as the Sahaba used to do, and feed the sheep and so on and so forth. They can feel that vibe. There's nothing. They've been doing for many years. I go to the butcher, you give your name, and then when the name comes, sometimes the ticket, the ticket that the meat comes in, he dropped, and they don't know where he belongs. They just change it. They don't even care. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You don't care. So there are other places in the Muslim land where they slaughter with a video and you can see your own sheep. Which one do you prefer? Ala kulli hal. But as I said, I respect every opinion. But as long as you don't put that down my throat and make it as if this is bid'ah, or this is haram, and this is I've read to you, Jazaakumullahu Khayr. I'm going to read it in Arabic from the book so you can see this is not my opinion, Jazaakumullahu Khayr. And then I agree with it 100%. قَالَ الْأَصْلُ فِي مَحَلِّ فُضْحِيَّ بَلَدٌ مُضَحِي. الأصل is your country. لأن إطعام الفقراء فيه تمتد إليها. To feed the فقراء is related to that. ومع هذا, with all of this in mind, فلا مانع من نقلها إلى غيره إذا ذاعت المصلحة إلى ذلك. There's no harm into transporting the أضحية into another country if there is a مصلحة benefit out of it. Of course, we're not going to say to put it in another country where they don't need it. مفهوم يا إخوان؟ طيب, الحمد لله بفضله ومنه, we finished the أضحية. That today the udhiyah is finished. Fadlallah. What was left is what we do in those 10 days to prepare. And salatul eid bi'idhillahi ta'ala. Hada wallahu ta'ala a'la wa a'lam. Wa subhanaka Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Wa subhana rabbika rabbil izzati amma yasifun. Wa salamun ala al-mursalin. Wa alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. 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 Alameen.